fact, the constitution says that the parliament may decide the way in which the union territories will return the members to the council of states. And the parliament has said that this will be done by an electoral college. Now, this electoral college shall not be confused with the electoral college which elects the president or which elects the vice president. This is a special electoral college which is created in the Union Territory specially for the purpose of returning members to the Rajya Sabha. Now, the original constitution provided for that two members of the Anglo-Indian community can be nominated by the president in the popular chamber if the president is satisfied that the community is not adequately represented in the Lok Sabha. The Union Legislature or the Parliament. The Parliament of India consists of three parts: the President, the Council of States, and the House of the People. In 1954, the Hindi names Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha were adopted respectively for the Council of States and the House of the People. The Council of States is the representation of the states at the central level. It is nothing but the federal house, and you can compare it with the House of the Lords. It is like the House of the Elders. Lok Sabha, on the other hand, is the representation of the people of India at the central level. So let's have a look at these two houses. So Article 79 to 122 in Part 5 of the Indian Constitution deal with the organization, composition, duration, officers. Officers means the presiding officers, the speaker, the chairman, the deputy speaker, the deputy chairman, etc. Procedures. It means what kind or how the proceedings would be taken forward in the houses. Privileges. It means what kind of advantages the members and the house collectively they have. Powers and so on of the parliament. Parliament of India consists of three parts, namely the president, the council of states, and the house of the people. In 1954, the Hindi names Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha were adopted by the Council of States and the House of the People respectively. Now let's have a look at the composition of the Rajya Sabha. As I told you already, that Rajya Sabha is the federal chamber. It gives representation to the states at the central level. Also, you must remember that in the fourth schedule, how much seats would be allocated to a particular state in the Rajya Sabha is mentioned. And when you make changes under Article 2 or Article 3, it may amend the first and the fourth schedules, but that does not tantamount to amendment of the constitution as provided under Article 368. So keep that thing in mind. So let's have a look at the composition of the Council of States. The maximum strength of the Rajya Sabha is fixed at 250. It means it cannot be more than that. Out of which 238 are the representatives of the states and the union territories. Obviously, they are indirectly elected in accordance with the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. It means very much similar, the election methodology that is followed for electing the president and the vice president of India. And 12 are nominated by the president from among people having distinctive achievements in fields like science, art, literature, social service, etc. At present, the Rajya Sabha's strength is 245. 233 is occupied by the states and union territories, 12 nominated members by the president. Now, how the states are represented? How does the states, they send their representatives in the Rajya Sabha? Well, they do it in an indirect fashion, and there is no direct election for filling the membership of the Rajya Sabha. In fact, it is the elected members of the state legislative assemblies that return the members to the Rajya Sabha by indirect election. And I'm saying indirectly, indirect when we look at it from the people's perspective directly. Therefore, it is an indirect election. Why? Because the representatives of the people are electing the members for the Rajya Sabha for that state concern. And this is done by the elected members of the legislative assemblies of that state. And in accordance with the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. It means there is no first past the post system applicable in the election of the Rajya Sabha. The election, let us have a look at it. The representatives of the states in the Rajya Sabha are elected by the elected members. This is what you need to keep in mind, of the state legislative assemblies. It means there is no role for the state legislative councils. The election is held in accordance with the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. When we say elected members of the state legislative assemblies, in fact, all the members in the state legislative assemblies are elected now, because the only nominated member who was from the Anglo-Indian community, that has been abolished by the 104th Constitutional Amendment or 126th Constitutional Amendment Bill, whatever you want to say. The seats are allotted to the states in the Rajya Sabha on the basis of population. So keep that thing in mind. And the number of representatives varies from state to state. And everything is mentioned in the fourth schedule. For example, a state like Uttar Pradesh has much larger number of seats in Rajya Sabha when compared to a state like Sikkim. Representation of union territories. How union territories will return their candidates to the Rajya Sabha. The representatives of each union territory in the Rajya Sabha are indirectly elected by the members of an electoral college specially constituted for the purpose in accordance with the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. In fact, the constitution says that the parliament may decide the way in which the union territories will return the members to the Council of States. And the parliament has said that this will be done by an electoral college. Now, this electoral college shall not be confused with the electoral college which elects the president or which elects the vice president. This is a special electoral college which is created in the union territory specially for the purpose of returning members to the Rajya Sabha. In fact, of all the union territories, only three have membership in the Rajya Sabha, and they are Delhi, Puducherry and Jammu and Kashmir. Why? Because the population of the rest is so less that they do not have adequacy with respect to the election of membership in Rajya Sabha is concerned. It means their population is insufficient for getting a Rajya Sabha seat. That's it. Nominated members. The president nominates 12 members to the Rajya Sabha from among people who have special knowledge or practical experience in the fields of art, literature, science and social service. So, the composition of Rajya Sabha is partly elected and partly nominated. The election here that you need to keep in mind is indirect and in accordance with the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. But as far as union territories is concerned, it is by an electoral college. For states, it is by the elected members of the legislative assemblies. Clear? So state legislative councils take no part, and not all the union territories have membership in the Rajya Sabha, because all of them do not have the sufficient population which is necessary for attaining a seat in the Rajya Sabha. So keep that thing in mind. Let's have a look at the composition of Lok Sabha. The maximum strength of Lok Sabha is fixed at 552. It means it cannot go beyond that. 530 members are to be representatives of the states, 20 members are to be representatives of the union territories, and 2 members are to be nominated by the president from the Anglo-Indian community. But you know that this has been abolished now by the 104th Constitutional Amendment Act. Now, at present, the Lok Sabha has 543 members. Of this, 524 members represent the states, 19 members represent the union territories, because you know that Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh have now been converted into union territories. So previously it was 530 states and 13 union territories, which made it 543. Now, you can just take 5 seats from Jammu and Kashmir and 1 seat from Ladakh, and they are now union territory. So you just add 13 plus 6, which becomes 19, or you subtract 530 minus 6, which becomes 524. Simple logic, right? The nomination of the 2 Anglo-Indian members has been abolished by the 104th Constitutional Amendment Act 2019. Now, the original constitution provided for that 2 members of the Anglo-Indian community can be nominated by the president in the popular chamber if the president is satisfied that the community is not adequately represented in the Lok Sabha. So, it was a kind of satisfaction of the president. Clear? But anyhow, that practice is abolished, so no need of discussing it any further. Representation of the states. How the states return the members to the Lok Sabha? Well, they do it by direct election, wherein the entire state is divided into geographical constituencies or territorial constituencies. And you know that the number of seats that are given to a state in the Lok Sabha is directly proportional to the population. Also, while allocating the seats to the Lok Sabha, two things are to be maintained. First, that the proportion of, or you can say the seats per population for all the states must be more or less similar. Or you can say that all the states must be given seats in proportion to their population. Suppose if one state has 200 people, say hypothetically for example, and it has been allocated one seat, another state which has 600 people must be allocated 3 seats. Therefore, you can say that the ratios are same for more or less all the states. As much as possible, that needs to be maintained first. And second, the number of constituencies that would be given to a particular state and the number of seats that would be allocated to a particular constituency must be same more or less for all the constituencies. It means, suppose there is a state which has two constituencies. In one constituency, the population is 200 and the number of seats given is 2. If in the other constituency, the population is 400, then the seats that would be given there must be 4. But here you must keep in mind that we have single member constituencies for the Lok Sabha, and the system is direct election, first past the post system. First past the post means whoever gets the largest number of votes is declared as the winner, notwithstanding that his votes is actually a majority of the total number of casted votes. So keep that in mind. So let's have a look at this. Representation of the states. The representatives of the states in the Lok Sabha are directly elected by the people from territorial constituencies in the states. The election is based on the principle of universal adult franchise. And this is a typical feature of the Indian Constitution. Remember the 61st constitutional amendment and universal adult franchise, the reduction of age and all of that. Clear? Now, representation of union territories. The Constitution has empowered the Parliament to prescribe the manner of choosing the representatives of the Union Territories in the Lok Sabha. Very much similar to the Rajya Sabha, the same powers has been conferred upon by the Constitution to the Parliament. Accordingly, the Parliament has enacted the Union Territories Direct Election to the House of the People Act 1965, by which the members of the Lok Sabha from the Union Territories are also chosen by direct election. So keep this in mind that as far as Lok Sabha is concerned, everything is direct election, and there was an element of nomination that has been abolished. The Constitution has adopted the system of territorial representation, first past the post system. It means the state is divided, or the union territory is divided into territorial or geographical blocks or territorial constituencies. Clear? And the system is first past the post system for the election of the members of the Lok Sabha. In this system, the voters cast their vote for a candidate of their choice, and the candidate who receives the most votes win. It is not necessary that he gets the majority of the total votes cast, but maximum number of votes, whoever will get the maximum number of votes will be declared as winner, notwithstanding that that maximum is not actually the majority of the total number of votes casted. Let's have a look at the territorial constituencies. For the purpose of holding direct elections to the Lok Sabha, each state is divided into territorial constituencies. In this respect, the Constitution makes the following two provisions. And what are they? Each state is allotted a number of seats in the Lok Sabha in such a manner that the ratio between the number and its population is same for all the states, as far as possible. This provision does not apply to a state having a population of less than 6 million. 6 million means 60 lakh. If you have less than 60 lakh population, then this is not applicable all the time, because then you cannot maintain that parity. Second, each state is divided into territorial constituencies in such a manner that the ratio between the population of each constituency and the number of seats allotted to it is the same throughout the state. It means two things. While allocating seats to the Lok Sabha for the states, or while allocating the seats to the states for the Lok Sabha rather, it must be maintained that all the states get seats in accordance with their population. And second, when you divide the seats for a particular state between the territorial constituencies of that state, ensure that individual constituency get the number of seats in accordance with their population. So the proportion must be maintained in two ways, interstate and intrastate. This is what you need to keep in mind. In brief, the constitution ensures that there is uniformity of representation in two respects, between the different states and between the different constituencies in the same state. Interstate and intrastate parity must be maintained as far as possible. But keep this in mind, not applicable for states which have population less than 6 million. Readjustment after each census. Now, after each census, a readjustment is to be made in what? Allocation of seats in the Lok Sabha to the states and division of each state into territorial constituencies. The parliament is empowered to determine the authority and the manner in which it is to be made. Accordingly, the parliament has enacted the Delimitation Commission Act. Now, this Delimitation Commission, which is very recently in news also, Delimitation Commission Acts, they determine how many seats would be given in the Lok Sabha to a particular state, and in that state, how many territorial constituencies will be there. 1952, 1962, 1972, it means after every census, you can say, and 2002 for this purpose. The 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act 1976 froze the allocation of seats in the Lok Sabha to the states and the division of each state into territorial constituencies till the year 2000 at the 1971 census level. And this was done especially to encourage the South Indian states, because which did an excellent job with respect to population control. And if you reduce the representation in the popular chamber, because they have successfully reduced the population, it would be a disincentive and they would abandon all population control programs. And therefore, this freezing was done. This ban on readjustment was extended by another 25 years, that is up to 2026, by the 84th Constitutional Amendment Act of 2001, with the same objective of encouraging population limiting measure. Because you know, that number of seats that are allocated to a particular state or union territory in the Lok Sabha is proportional to its population. So keep that thing in mind. Also, the Lok Sabha has a proposal of reservation of seats for the SCs and STs. But keep this in mind, that the makers of Indian Constitution have abandoned the practice of separate electorate, the Moral Memento reforms, and you know that how it finally sowed the seeds of partition in the country. Anyhow, that separate electorate has been removed, but reservation in the legislature has been made, and it is an act of positive discrimination for the upliftment of the vulnerable section of the population. But though the seats are reserved for the members of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe community, the electoral role is a general electoral role. It means it is not a special electoral role, right? During the pre-partition days, or you can understand that during the pre-independence days, there was separate electorate roles. And this is when, you know, all that Pakistan movement started, and which finally led to the lamentable partition of the country. But that has been amended. So seats are reserved, but the electoral role are general electoral role. So let's have a look at that. Though the constitution has abandoned the system of communal representation, that is separate electorates, it provides for the reservation of seats for the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in the Lok Sabha on the basis of population ratios. Originally, this reservation was to operate for 10 years, that is up to 1960, but it has now been extended continuously since then by 10 years each time. Now, under the 104th Constitutional Amendment, it has been further extended to by another 10 years, January 25, 2030. This is the same constitutional amendment which abolished the nomination of Anglo-Indian members, both at the union and at the state level. So keep that also in mind. Though seats are reserved for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, they are elected by all the voters in a constituency without any separate electorate. So there is a reservation of seats. It means members of the scheduled castes and scheduled tribe can only get elected from those seats, but everybody can vote for them, and there is no discrimination at the electoral roll level. So keep that in mind.